Well, good morning, and can I welcome everybody to this, the 23rd meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022. The first item on our agenda is for members of the committee to agree to take agenda items 4 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you very much. We've got two items of public evidence gathering this morning on our agenda. And the first of those is to look at the National Fraud Initiative in Scotland 2022 report, which has been prepared by Audit Scotland. And our two witnesses this morning that I'm very pleased to welcome in the committee room are Anthony Clark, Executive Director of Performance Audit and Best Value. And this morning, Anthony is joined by Anne Cairns, who's the manager, Performance Audit and Best Value at Audit Scotland. We've got some questions to put, but before we get to those, Anthony, could I ask you to make a short opening statement?
Thank you. Good morning, Convener, and good morning, committee members. Anne and I are delighted to be with you today this morning to brief you on Audit Scotland's report on the Natural Fraud Initiative in Scotland 2022, which we published on the 18th of August earlier this year. As the committee members probably know, the NFI is a counter-fraud exercise across the UK public sector, which uses data matching to help prevent and detect fraud. It looks for fraud and error related to things like blue badges, public sector pensions and council tax discounts, and it's an exercise that takes place every 2 years. 132 public sector bodies in Scotland participated in the NFI exercise in 2020-21. That's an increase of eight since the previous exercise 2 years ago. And alongside the report which we have in front of us today, Audit Scotland also published some more detailed analysis of the findings on different organisations and different sectors and different localities so the public can get a picture of what's happening in their area. And we think that communication of the findings of this exercise is really important as part of the deterrent effect of the NFI. And I'll briefly, if I may, just highlight some of the key messages in the report. Outcomes valued at £14.9 million were identified in this exercise. And the cumulative outcomes from the NFI since it started in 2006-2007 are now £158.5 million in Scotland, with a cumulative total across the whole of the UK of £2.4 billion. There's been a fall of £400,000 in the amount of outcomes recorded in Scotland since our last report, so that's a small fall this year compared to the exercise 2 years ago. We can't say exactly what this is down to, but we think there are a number of reasons why this might have happened. Partly to do with, we think, less fraud and error in the system. People are learning lessons from previous exercises, improving their controls. We think there are stronger internal controls in place in a number of public bodies. And it's also quite likely that the fall may be caused partly by the fact that data matching to do with payroll and pensions is now being done separately by the DWP with local authorities on a real-time basis. And that's one of the areas where we used to identify housing benefit fraud, so it's been picked up elsewhere. A key benefit of participating in the UK-wide exercise is that data can be shared between bodies across national borders, and data submitted by Scottish bodies in this exercise helped other organisations in Scotland and across the UK to identify outcomes of £1.2 million. I'm pleased to say that most organisations demonstrate a strong commitment to counter fraud in the NFI, but a lower percentage of participating bodies manage their role in this year's exercise as well as we would have liked. There's been a slight deterioration in the quality of participation amongst public bodies. External auditors have identified areas for public bodies to improve their participation in the future, and that's something they'll be following up with the bodies concerned. As you know, we've discussed this on a number of occasions with your predecessor committee, PAPLS. Audit Scotland is always keen to develop the NFI, and we've undertaken a number of pilot exercises which have been looking at new ways of data matching to see whether they will prove to be fruitful in identifying fraud. And we set those out in the report in pages 20 to 23, and I suspect we may want to talk to you a bit more about the pilot exercises and what they found. Finally, Audit Scotland continues to work with the Cabinet Office and the Scottish Government to develop new ways to prevent and detect fraud, and we set out how we're doing that in page 24 of the report. Convener, as always, and then I are very happy to answer any questions from committee members.
Right, Anthony, thank you very much indeed. And I've got a couple of questions to get us underway. The first thing I have to say that it struck me was the cases identified, and I think it's led to four prosecutions by the police. I mean, the cases identified are largely small-scale, household-level examples of fraud or individual fraud. I mean, is part of this exercise designed at all to look kind of wider spread, I don't know, organised crime fraud or you know, examples of much bigger coordinated attempts to defraud the system?
I think it's important to recognise that the process that we have through the NFI is really designed to look at many of the large-scale systems and processes that are in place within public bodies and to identify whether or not there are systemic problems that can be addressed. So to that extent, I think if we did see systemic problems and they could be linked to serious and organised crime, we would obviously follow that up. But it's not the purpose of this exercise, Mr Leonard. We have a range of other arrangements in place to look at the quality of fraud and counter-fraud arrangements within public bodies through internal audit, external audit, and also many public bodies have their own counter-fraud teams as well. We in Audit Scotland liaise very closely with Police Scotland around this work, as well as the Cabinet Office, but that isn't the purpose of this exercise primarily, Mr Leonard.
OK, that's a helpful clarification. Thanks for that. You've identified the amount identified in this exercise was slightly down on the figure identified in 2020, which would have been the last time the exercise was undertaken. I mean, do you see that as a sign of success, that there's a growing public awareness, or do you see that as a sign of failure, that more fraud has gone undetected?
It's a brilliant question. I'm always slightly cautious about answering this question, because it's cropped up in a number of times when predecessors have been in front of the papals. And I think we feel that it probably is a sign of success in many ways, that people are learning the lessons that were identified in previous NFI exercises. I'll bring Anne in a short while once I've given my initial answer. But we do know from our liaison with auditors, with the Cabinet Office and with participating bodies that people are learning the lessons and sharing good practice. There's a whole network of agencies and arrangements that sit alongside the NFI and wider counter-fraud activity, which are used to share good practice. So I think what we do see in this NFI report is an example of people learning lessons, strengthening controls. I wouldn't want to be complacent because, you know, it's a bit of a known unknown, I think, this. I don't think anybody could sit here with confidence and say to you whether or not fraud is increasing or decreasing across the public sector. It's a very volatile and changing environment. The reason why we had some of these pilot exercises this year is because new funding streams come into play, new systems get introduced. So I think it would be very, very difficult to say fraud in year X is X percent, fraud in year Y is Y percent, and what balances, what if you understand my drift. Nice. But Anne, do you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, thank you. I think we really shouldn't be complacent. Over the last couple of years, we've actually issued a report to sort of the audited bodies, and it's on our website for the general public, about new emerging risks that we identified as coming into play during the COVID pandemic. So that's one additional challenge that public sector has had to deal with. I think the outcomes have gone down because the local auditors, the external auditors and the audited bodies have identified previous control weaknesses through previous outcomes identified in the previous NFI exercise, and they've actually followed that up with the bodies to ensure they've strengthened their controls. So that's obviously a positive. On a sort of negative side, we are seeing the public bodies having been struggling over the last couple of years just due to COVID resource pressures, sickness absence, etc. Although having said that, as Anthony said, the majority of them have participated in the NFI. They have dealt and reviewed their high-risk matches, the ones we would really expect them to do, and they have got there, not as maybe as timorously as in the previous exercise, but they have got there. In the current exercise, we also had, you'll see through reports, was a few data sets that weren't included this time round. For example, the immigration data wasn't included due to restrictions placed on it by the Home Office, and obviously the housing benefit data is now being matched in through DWP systems, which was another source of significant outcomes in previous exercises. And also we've had some challenges around about the legalities of patient data that we're still working our way through. So again, those matches haven't been included, and those are the areas that we would have expected outcomes had it been, you know, on a like-for-like basis to previous exercises. So it's a bit of a kind of mixed picture, really. There are some positives, but also some negatives.
Thank you. And some of those areas you've identified, Anne, I think members of the committee will be asking further detailed questions about. Just one thing that I think, Anne, both you mentioned and Anthony, you mentioned in your opening statement, which was something that the report alluded to, which was that this time there appeared to be a greater reliance on external agents, which I presume is a euphemism for outsourcing of some of the data matching work. And my first question is, do you have any reflections on whether that affected the quality of the data matching exercises? And secondly, was there any pattern there? In other words, for example, was it smaller local authorities that were maybe struggling more through COVID and its effects that were having to rely on outsourcing some of that work? Or was it big local authorities, for example, or big public agencies, for example, as well, that were doing that?
If I might just answer the first question around the data quality, and then I'll hand over to Anne to talk about the nature of the agents and where they were used. I think we're very satisfied that the quality of the data that was submitted and the quality of the data we reported in this exercise is as good as previous NFI exercises. We wouldn't have published the report had that not been the case. And there are very strong and robust quality assurance arrangements across all of the UK audit agencies, Cabinet Office and others to make sure that's the case. Anne may want to say a little bit more about the specifics of where agents were used and why that was the case, if that's OK, Anne.
Yeah, that's fine. Thanks, Anthony. Yeah, we had a few councils who decided to use external contractors in respect to their council tax single-person discount matches. There was a few reasons for that. You know, some of them, the timing of the NFI didn't suit them because, as you appreciate, it's a once every 2 year exercise, so they could do it when they wanted, you know, as they wanted. Some of them were maybe had other contracts with the external provider doing data matching in different areas, and therefore it was sort of bolt onto an existing arrangement. It wasn't sort of prevalent over whether it was large authorities or small authorities. It tended to be sort of the sort of medium-sized authorities. Although I have had discussions with one authority who was considering and had previously used an external contractor for some of this work last week, and they've actually decided, you know, actually we'll just use the NFI going forward. I should also point out that the NFI is only one of the many tools in the council's counter-fraud toolkit. So, you know, as long as they're actually doing the work, we're generally content, you know, they're addressing the sort of fraud issue. So we don't sort of be too harsh on them. But, yeah, you know, there's a few who have gone down that route.
OK, thanks. We've got some more questions in this area, and I'm going to bring in Colin Beattie, first of all, who wants to follow this line of questioning up. Colin.
Thank you, Vera. Good morning. I suppose it's pretty mixed for this particular NFI outturn. I mean, it's good to see there's 8 additional participants, and the spread of participants, number of participants, has been part of an ongoing discussion between this committee and the Auditor General over an extended period, and that's still unresolved. But there are some key points that I would like to bring up. In page 4 of your report, states that immigration data was not included in 2018, 19 and 2021 exercises due to restrictions placed by the Home Office. Can you tell me a little bit more about the restrictions that the Home Office has put in place that results in immigration data not being included?
I'll give a brief overview and then hand over to Anne. She may want to add a bit more detail. This situation arose as a consequence of the Home Office's review into the Windrush generation issues. And it was as a consequence of that review exercise that the lawyers in the Home Office determined that it wouldn't be appropriate for immigration data to be shared with us as part of the NFI exercise, and indeed other agencies that are participating as well. Is there a bit more detail we can add on that, Anne?
That was the sort of main reason initially why the Home Office gave for not sharing the data. They wanted to review their own data before they started sharing it with other bodies. More recently, they have been looking at alternative ways of sharing data with public sector bodies, for example, through the Digital Economy Act, as a sort of wider project. So at present, the Cabinet Office are still in discussions with the Home Office about trying to get more or get immigration data back into the NFI, but as yet that's not been successful.
So we don't know when that data, you know, for the next exercise, we don't know if the data will be there either.
We don't, but I think we would hope that this would be resolved in the forthcoming period. I mean, it's 2 years before the next exercise. One would hope that it would be resolved by then, Mr. Beattie.
What was the impact of that? What's the impact of not having that that data?
Do you want to have a go at this? Or do you want
The immigration data was really helpful in relation to student award data, in that, you know, we were identifying students who were here getting funding from Student Award Agency in Scotland, and they weren't entitled to it because, you know, their immigration had expired or whatever. We were also finding some of the payroll data. Typically, it was NHS bodies that were finding they had employees who their immigration status had changed and they weren't aware. So it was really roundabout sort of payroll and student award matches that were impacted this time.
And if I might just say, I think we're all conscious that there have been quite a few different requirements placed on employers, both public and private sector employers, around identifying and being confident that the immigration status of members of staff and employees are as they should be. So this is just another adjunct to the NFI work as well.
I would have thought if they're giving the excuse that this is about Windrush, Windrush is a fairly discreet number of people. Is it really impacting that much on the big picture?
I don't think we can really...
Is that what they're actually saying, that it impacts on a wide number of people?
Our understanding is that the advice, the legal advice or the legal considerations within the Home Office is that they felt that it wouldn't be appropriate for this NFI exercise to share immigration data because of some of the broader issues that were identified through the way in which some of the people that arrived in England as part of the Windrush generation had been treated. So it's, I think it's part of a wider set of considerations that have had an impact on the NFI rather than being a specific NFI issue.
OK. And just still on page 4 of the report, there's also a question about residential care home data. Direct payments and social care customers' data weren't matched in the 2021 exercise due to legal question being raised about the definition of patient data. Can you tell us a bit more about that legal issue and has it been resolved? Will it be resolved soon?
Yeah, I can give you a bit of a sense of what the legal issue is, and I might ask Anne to either add a bit more colour and then confirm whether or not this has been resolved. This issue arose because there has been a difference of opinion about the extent to which social care data should be treated as patient data. And the legal advice that there is within, is it the Home Office?
The Cabinet Office.
The Cabinet Office, sorry, is that they believe that some aspects of social care data should be treated as patient data. And therefore, for that reason, it wasn't possible to include some social care data as part of this NFI exercise. That issue is seeking to be being resolved. I'm not entirely sure whether it has been resolved yet, and I don't think it has it?
No. The real issue is, in the legislation, the lawyers in the Cabinet Office started to look at this area of the NFI and started to question whether the data that the councils were submitting could be classed as patient data. You know, we're typically talking about people that get care in home or in the sort of nursing homes, and they came to the view that that could be classed as patient data. In legislation, the definition of patient data can be read several ways, and you could, you know, say that that was patient data. In the legislation for the data matching exercises that we are permitted to carry out, and indeed what the Cabinet Office are carried out, it actually says if we take patient data from an NHS body, the matches as a result of the data matching have to be released to the NHS body. And obviously a council isn't an NHS body, so we could take the data from the councils and do the matching, but we wouldn't be able to release the matches back to the council. So I've been working with the Cabinet Office legal team to try and resolve this issue, and the English Local Audit and Accountability Act, we think there might be a way of amending that piece of legislation. Jacob Rees-Mogg's been involved, and he, up until fairly recently, until he changed position, he was quite supportive of thinking we might be able to get a change to that that would allow us to take this data from the councils, do the matching, and release the matches back to the councils. The Cabinet Office lawyers Still haven't signed that off. They're still considering it. But that's where we're at, and we're actively trying to get this in as soon as possible.
Is there a way around this by releasing the information back to the Health and Social Care Partnership within the Council?
I don't think that would be possible under the legislation, Mr. Beattie. The same issue would arise.
Yeah, it has to go back to a health board.
So the obvious question is, what has the impact been?
It means that we haven't been able to do those data matches and identify whether any outcomes would arise as a consequence of the data matching.
And in the past, have you had discrepancies?
Yes.
Yeah. In the past, we've identified mainly people who are in care homes, nursing homes, who have unfortunately passed away. The care home haven't notified, or the council hasn't been notified, and the council has continued to pay the monthly bill to the care home until the match was identified and the payment was stopped.
So potentially it can be significant.
Yeah.
Okay. Just carrying on, this page 4 of the report's got a lot of bad news on it.
Let's hope we can move on to the good news soon then.
It says in connection with the deletion of data for 11 councils, inadvertently deleted, so full documentation is not available for these councils. The Cabinet Office has taken steps to prevent this error from reoccurring, hopefully. So what impact has that had? I mean, you know, this obviously affects, I think, council tax discounts, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So what's the impact been, particularly for those 11 councils concerned?
I am going to hand this one over to Anne, because she was much more involved in the specifics of this than I was, if you forgive me.
Thanks, Anthony. Yeah, this was human error. That, you know, it's nothing to do with the IT or anything else. It was human error. And what happened was, due to Data Protection Act, at the end of each exercise, as you would imagine, the data that's no longer required is deleted. And when the head of the NFI was signing off the data deletion instruction to the IT contractor, instead of saying the previous exercise, the data was to be deleted up until November, actually an error said December. And by he didn't pick that up. The person who second checked it didn't pick that up. It was signed off. And of course, the IT contractors just do what's in the instruction. And it was unfortunately deleted. The impact for those...
So am I correct in saying there's 1 month data deleted?
Well, it's not as simple as that, because in that month, that was the month that those councils uploaded their data. Yeah, so it's not just 1 month of matches. So those matches stayed in the system for about a year. The councils were able to work on them, but it did disappear. So it did mean the councils were able to work on the matches because it wasn't deleted immediately. But we don't have the detail. You know, for example, when you look at the report on the system for the council tax matches and the outcomes, you could see, like, council tax and Cairns, there's the match, here's the outcome, this is our address, that's our council tax, that's what we've recorded an outcome, say £500, and that's the dates and that's the reason why. That has all gone. What is there is just a summary, management information summary report for each of those 11 councils. We have said to the councils obviously involved, does this look, you know, realistic? Does that feel like the right sort of value to try and verify that the figure in the summary report was right? Obviously, they don't have the full detail and the full information behind. Some of the councils have got some records behind that. You know, if they were working offline on a certain number of cases, they have been able to verify some of it. But overall, we don't have evidence to say that's the figure of the outcomes and that's made up of all these cases and these values. We have obviously raised this with the Cabinet Office, and they have assured us they've implemented new controls and new arrangements around data deletion.
How confident are you about these new controls? I mean, the fact is, it was a human error. An instruction was given, an instruction was checked, and then released to the contractor who acted on it. But why wouldn't that happen again? I mean, what are they going to do now? Have triple checks? Quadruple checks?
They have implemented some automation in the system as well, so that, you know, I don't really understand all that, I'm not an IT expert, but they have implemented some sort of automation so that if data is deleted or asked to be deleted and it's out with the sort of normal range, though. So if it was due to be deleted up to the November, it would say, wait a minute, you were asking for December, are you sure, type thing, as well as the members of staff being involved are mortified.
We can give you a categoric assurance, of course, Mr. Beattie, that these things won't happen again. Human error is part of life, regrettably. But I think we're as confident as we can be that people have done as much as they can to avoid this happening again. It's a very regrettable thing. We're all very disappointed.
So there's hope.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Willie Coffey wanted to come in on this area. Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener. Just on that issue there, this particular type of issue has come to the Audit Committee before about data and data loss and whether there's backup data that could have been retrieved to have prevented this. Was there any discussion about that? Did they destroy the backup data as well, did they?
Yeah. Again, I'm not an IT expert, but I did ask that question because, you know, that was my immediate thing. Well, can you not just wind back the clock to whatever date it was deleted? And the IT contractor went away and looked at that. When we identified this issue, it was when we're drafting the report. You know, we're trying to verify the figures, as you can imagine. So we're talking sort of May, June time this year, and we were trying to verify the numbers, and we were like, well, where's that number coming from? And we were struggling. That's when we went to the Cabinet Office and we said, we actually raised the issue with them. They weren't aware of it. And they said, oh, sorry, the data's been deleted. And that was one of my first questions. Can you just turn the clock back? And apparently they could do that, but it would mean everything that had been input into the NFI system since that date, so, you know, say it went back to the December, everything that had been subsequently input would have been deleted. So we would have corrected one thing, but we would have created issues in every other set of data that was in the system.
If I may, Convener, just to make a more general point around here, I think for me this reinforces the value of people moving to more real-time matching of data. So we have a more preventative model of identifying risks as and when they present. I think the NFI exercise is a really important exercise. We wouldn't do it. We wouldn't bring the report to you if we didn't think it was an important part of the, if you like, fraud and fraud kind of management and dealing with kind of toolkit. But I do think it says to me that the merits of people sharing data on a real-time basis across different agencies is another important part of this work. I also think this reinforces the importance of people identifying and putting in place improvement actions on the back of the work. This is an example of something having gone wrong. In this report and in the report that Anne referred to earlier, our fraud and irregularity report that we share with all public bodies and auditors, we identify problems. I think this is an important bit of the learning that needs to go on all the time around fraud and corruption.
I'm now going to bring in Deputy Convener Sharon Dowie, who's got some questions to follow a particular area of inquiry. Sharon.
Good morning. Page 9 of the report provides outcomes on information in the blue badge outcomes. There appears to have been a significant rise in the number of blue badge outcomes, with your report showing an increase of 44% more matches identified compared to the last NFI exercise. Are you aware of any reasons that may have led to this increase?
Yes, thank you very much for the question. I think the honest answer to this question is no one entirely knows quite what the reason is, but the feedback we've had from at least one local authority that has looked into this in a degree of detail is that they think that it may be a consequence of the COVID-19 pandemic and the higher mortality rates that people saw during COVID-19. So that seems to be the kind of sense we've got as to what might be prompting that increase. That's the answer to the question, I think. I don't think Anne has anything more to add to that, do you, necessarily?
No, not really. As I say, we've had anecdotal information from councils. In general, they were finding the COVID pandemic adversely impacted, unfortunately, on people who tended to be on sort of disability benefits. And obviously people who had blue badges were part of that. And as I say, those people unfortunately passed away. And due to the pandemic and, you know, everything being in sort of lockdown, the badges maybe weren't, people didn't know where to hand in the badges, you know, the councils were shut, etc., etc. So when we did the data matching, councils were finding that there was still a number of badges out there in circulation for people who had died.
And obviously, when we repeat the exercise in 2 years' time, we'll be able to, if you like, that'll give us a sense of whether or not this was a one-off blip or whether there's a more systemic problem. I think, had there been a more systemic problem beyond that, I think councils would have been reporting that to us as part of the NFI exercise. So I think that's our suspicion at the moment.
OK, thanks for that. Moving on to pensions, there's clearly been a significant drop in the value of pension outcomes that have been identified by the NFI exercise, which the report suggests is down to improved effectiveness. So this is obviously very welcome news. What further steps do you think could be taken to reduce the 1.5 million of outcomes that were detected?
Gosh, that's a good question. I am kind of struggling to think of a single answer to that one, Sharon, to be perfectly honest. I mean, the sense we've got from this exercise, as you've just said, is that the matches that were identified through the NFI, which we shared with SBPA and the appropriate pension bodies themselves, were ones that they were picking up through their own control risks and so on and so forth. So it does feel as though the control environment around pensions is relatively robust and relatively strong. So I'm not sure there's a single thing I could sit here and say to you, we need to solve X or Y that will reduce that. That makes like a council of doom, like we just have to accept it. I'm not saying we should just accept that this is a level of fraud or errors within the pension system, but I can't think of a single obvious thing to say. I don't know, Fionn, if you've got any silver bullet here.
I don't have a silver bullet, but what I would say, these tend to be, obviously this matches for people who have died, unfortunately, and the pension has remained in payment. And I suppose to make any real headway improvement would be if somehow we were able to move to real-time reporting. You know, if the pension funds were able to get real-time information, you know, when someone had passed away. I mean, they are using sort of tellers ones, and they are strengthening their controls, and that has, as you can see, resulted in a significant drop in outcomes. We actually looked quite closely at these outcomes because I was like, oh my goodness, what's going on here? And they did review, they got quite a number of matches and we looked at them and they had properly investigated and reviewed them. And it was just, they got the matches because of a time indifference. So we were saying, no, someone has died. By the time they reviewed it and looked at it, they'd already actioned it in the time period between the data getting submitted and the matches coming out. So I suppose the only real way to improve, I would suggest, would be some kind of real-time information.
OK, thank you.
Thanks, Sharon. Craig Hoy has now got some questions to put to you. Craig.
Good morning, Mr Clark. I'd like to maybe just probe a little bit more about housing benefit council tax reduction and then ask just a couple of questions in relation to recovery and prosecution. On housing benefit, page 11 of the report states that the NFI exercise identified 177 cases of housing benefit overpayments, which had a value of £1.2 million, which is a significant drop over the prior years. The report explains that this reduction is mainly due to the use of the Department of Work and Pensions Verify Earnings and Pensions Alert System. So can you tell us when the DWP system came into use here in Scotland, and whether you have a degree of certainty that that is the reason for that underlying drop?
I think I can give you some assurance that we think that is the reason for the drop. I can't give you the date at which the system was introduced, but maybe Anne will be able to.
I can't remember exactly. It was before the pandemic, but it's been a sort of emerging system from the DWP. The DWP implemented its accuracy award initiative, as it was called, and that was before the pandemic. That's a kind of but initially it was on a voluntary basis, so councils were getting matches and it was down to themselves whether they opted to review them or not. The DWP have progressed the scheme and made it sort of mandatory for all councils to participate. And the matches actually come through on a daily basis to councils. They are risk scored. So top of the pile every morning will be the highest risk one for that day. If that one isn't actioned today, it may still be number one tomorrow, or it may drop down if there was another one come in of higher risk. The councils receive funding from the DWP to action those matches. And as for the actual outcomes, the DWP haven't actually reported any sort of outcomes or results from that as yet. Right. What the DWP report is the overall level of fraud and error in the benefit system. So and part of that reporting, there is a section on housing benefit, but it's not specific just down to the VEP system.
Okay. I mean, I think the figures do speak for themselves. I think 18-19 it was 1,238 cases, and then obviously most recently 177. So it does seem to be the sort of causal link. But just looking at the sum of the overpayments, the report states that the average individual value of housing benefit overpayments has risen from £2,300 effectively in 18-19 to nearly £6,700 in 2021. Are you aware of any particular reasons for that quite significant jump?
I'm going to have to ask Anne to answer that, I'm very sorry.
That's fine, thanks. We don't have any specific information on why that is the case. It could be down to many factors. You know, it could be the rent levels have gone up, or it could be the ones that they were identifying were taking longer to be identified. You know, so they were, you know, they were running for quite a significant period of time. The matching that was taking place in the NFI wasn't against the payroll. So usually when you match against payroll, you find it worse or regular quicker. Some of these are being matched against sort of right to buy cases in England or other housing records in another council. So I don't know the particular reason, but I would hazard a guess it's maybe they've been going on for a sort of longer period in time than in the previous exercise when it was just people's fluctuating earnings.
Okay, so there's probably work in progress in relation to that, to try and identify what that sum has risen.
And given you that as a question, Mr Hoy, it's something we'll look at when we do the next exercise.
Just turning to the council tax reduction, page 13 of the report states that councils identified 772 cases with a total outcome of 0.7 million in 2021. And this is 2.5 times the number of cases identified in 2018-19. It appears that the report suggests that councils are of the view that this may directly be caused by the COVID-19 pandemic. Do you want to elaborate on that? What particularly in relation to the pandemic might have resulted in that increase?
Yeah, we think it's possibly to do with the volatility of the employment market during the COVID-19 pandemic and people's roles changing, people moving in and out of employment, and also people, I think is probably the main driver there really, and then the challenges that presents in terms of having up-to-date and accurate information to support council tax reduction activity.
Okay, just a couple of slightly broader questions. One is, given the relatively low number of prosecutions that are coming forward and also the cost of living crisis, would you expect to see potential fraudulent activity increase during a period of economic downturn?
I think it creates a higher risk environment for fraud and also for errors for some of the reasons we've already discussed this morning at the committee. So I think that is plausible, Mr Hoy, yes.
Okay.
And perhaps more generally, if I might say, I think the report makes clear that during the COVID-19 pandemic, people were conscious of the elevated risks. Anne's already mentioned the briefing paper we put out, which is emerging fraud risks around COVID-19. That set out a whole range of new risks that were emerging as a consequence of the COVID-19 pandemic. And obviously, the cost of living crisis isn't the same thing as COVID-19, but it has some common characteristics. So we think people being alert to the emerging COVID-19 fraud risks is important in the context of the cost of living crisis. It's also important to say that we've mentioned earlier today, there are a whole range of groups that consider fraud across the public sector and talked about some of those national networks. We know that they'll also be thinking very hard about what are the new issues that are emerging as a consequence of the cost of living crisis. Our emerging fraud risk report set out how many public bodies had strengthened their anti-fraud and counter-fraud activity as a consequence of COVID-19. I think it's very likely that similar activity will be taking place as a consequence of the cost of living crisis.
Yeah. And just on that broader issue of recovery and prosecution, I think the public might be quite shocked to see £15 million potentially fraud and overpayment in one single year and £160 million in total since the initiative began. And yet in the year we're looking at only 4 cases being referred for prosecution in Scotland, and that obviously doesn't mean that necessarily there'll be a legal sanction against them. So just looking at a couple of the case studies that you used to highlight the examples of fraud, obviously I think in relation to an example of non-domestic rates and the small business bonus scheme where a ratepayer failed to declare other business premises, resulting in £11,000 overpayment. That is the first business case, business rates case to be reported for prosecution in Scotland, apparently. So obviously there is action there. But then we see in relation to pensions, we have an example of somebody who claimed, I think was it £10,560 and an overpayment of £6,600. They received a police caution and a full amount was repaid. And then we see a case in relation to a council tax claimant who failed to declare pension contributions and a pension lump sum. But they effectively made off with nearly £15,000 and the amount was being recovered by the council, but there's no reference to any prosecution or any reporting to the fiscal. So is there a sense here within the system that effectively we're getting tough on recovery, but on sanction and prosecution there still seems to be quite a light touch approach?
I'm not sure that's the conclusion I draw from the work, Mr. Hoy. I mean, I think it's important to say that the NFI is one part of the fraud and corruption toolkit, and it's not designed, if you like, to solely focus on the point you've raised. Local audit teams, both internal and external audit, look at this. The counter-fraud teams within public bodies look at this as well. So the case leaders who are identified in this report are the ones that are identified through the NFI process. Yeah. There are other cases that have been identified through annual audit, external audit, and whistleblowing activity as well. Okay. I think it's probably worth me saying that the reason why we've reported this NFI report is directly at the request of your predecessor committee, Papples committee, because questions were asked about, so what happens when there's a fraud identified? Yeah. And we felt it was appropriate for us to highlight what happens in terms of prosecutions. It's a small number, you're quite right.
Yeah.
But it's also important, I think, to recognise that this is a lagging thing. So we've identified four cases in this report. There may be more that will be prosecuted in the future.
Okay.
And there's also a risk exercise that needs to take place within public bodies about the cost-benefit of proceeding to prosecution based on the actual levels of the funds involved as well. I don't know if Han wants to add anything further to that, but I think that's our assessment of how this looks. That's not to say that there isn't more work to do in this area. I think it's really important to send the right signals to the public about public money counts,
yeah,
and that there are there's a price to pay, if you like, for illegal activity. But I don't think I'd draw the same conclusion from this report as the one that you draw, Mr. Hoy.
Yeah, thanks, Anthony. Yeah, basically we leave it down to the individual council to speak to the fiscal, or some of the councils can actually report cases directly for prosecution. So it's down to their own judgment, however, whether they take it forward. Having said that, I do know most councils, as Anthony said, does a sort of cost-benefit analysis type thing. You know, so if someone puts their hand up, shall we say, and says, you know, yeah, OK, I got that wrong, or yeah, you caught me, and they start paying it back, they tend not to take it forward for prosecution unless it's a significant value or it's a high value of interest, you know, as a public interest case. So I know in practice that tends to be what happens. It is a low number. But as Anthony said, there are other counter-fraud activity taking place, mainly in councils, which is getting reported, and they do report it to committees, they do report cases on their websites.
Yeah, I think that just identifies my concern, which is if you were to steal £14,000 from your neighbour, then that would perceive to be a pretty heinous crime. But because of the size of council budgets, you steal £14,000 from a council, and it appears that as long as they get the money back, there's no legal sanction, which I think is an underlying concern, but I'm sure we can return to that another day. Thanks, Richard.
Yes, that might be a philosophical point, Mr. Hoy. Can I just have a look a little bit more closely at the pilots? So one of the pilots which is highlighted in the report is one that was undertaken in Fife Council, looking at the national entitlement cards for travel. Part one of my question is, how long did that pilot take place for? What period did that pilot cover?
Anne, I think I know you were very heavily involved in this one. So Anne worked very closely with Fife Council, so she'll be able to give you chapter and verse. And in fact, I'm conscious that we need to probably finish about 12, so I just meant that she's got an awful lot to say about this if you really want to know.
Thanks, Anthony. Basically, it was done over the last year. So Fife Council volunteered to participate in the pilot, which was fantastic of them. And basically, they uploaded all their national entitlement cards. We used Fife Council. They worked with the National Entitlement Card Office, and they helped to upload the data And they worked through the matches. They got the matches and they worked through them, finishing sort of earlier this year in the springtime, and obviously recorded the outcomes. Every match that we identified was a positive outcome.
OK. But again, I just want to inject a sense of perspective into this. So over the course of a year in this pilot, and presumably it's a pilot to understand whether this is a line of inquiry worth pursuing or not, you know, whether the resources required to be invested in it will reap, you know, a significant harvest. And so the report says, out of all the cases in Fife over the course of that year, 13 matches showed cause for concern, as the NECs appeared to be have been used after the death of the cardholder. Two of these cards were used to journeys to the value of almost £2,300. I don't know where you can get from Fife 2 for that kind of money, but £2,300 for one and £240 for the other. The value of the journeys of the other 11 cards varied from £3.10 to £69. I mean, one, it seems to me to show how honest the good people of Fife are. But secondly, I mean, does that indicate that there is a major problem that requires lots of resources to be turned over to extending that from a pilot to a national level scheme?
I think the answer to that question is we're not sure at the moment. We're not convinced that this is one that merits rollout across the whole of Scotland. And we're reflecting on that with Fife Council and also the bodies that are involved in this more generally in Scotland. I mean, Anne, you've been having discussions, haven't you, with the relevant people. So I think we're just weighing that up quite hard. More generally, I think, both in terms of the mandating of bodies participation in the NFI and indeed pilots and rollouts of new initiatives, we're very conscious of the cost benefit of this. You know, it takes people's time to participate in the process. There has to be real public value. I think the report sets out that we would only ever want to extend the NFI if we thought it was going to offer real benefits. So if it's going to identify a small number of very big outcomes, or if it's going to identify a lot of small outcomes that add up to a big number, then those are the criteria that we reflect on in terms of, is it worth rolling this out? We're weighing that all up very hard at the moment, Mr. Leonard, in relation to the National Entitlement Card NFI participation in the future.
Yeah, I mean, a single bus journey at £3.10, you know, maybe not worthy of a major national exercise in trying to understand what's going on. The other area that you mentioned as a pilot, which is of interest, is the pilot that's underway with Social Security Scotland. And I think you're looking in particular at, in that pilot, whether there are examples of people who are claiming benefits as if residents in Scotland, but actually are not residents in Scotland, and also any cases where people have got maybe multiple addresses but are therefore putting in multiple claims. How many matches have you found through that pilot?
I mean, they're in the process of reviewing the matches at the moment, so obviously we can't report on any outcomes, but your question is how many matches were there? I don't have, have those figures directly to hand. I don't know whether Anne does. And if not, we can always write back to you, Mr. Leonard, with that.
But, I mean, do you get a sense of the scale of that? Is it National Entitlement Card Fife kind of levels, or is it much more widespread?
I think I'd need to just double-check, to be honest, Mr. Okay. I'm reluctant to give you an answer without being confident of the figures in front of me.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that. But if you could get back to us with those figures, that would be helpful.
Sorry, I was just going to make a more general point.
Yes, of course, please.
I mean, this is one area where we think there may be fruitful work to do, depending upon what the finding of the pilot exercise is. And given the increased responsibilities we have in Scotland for Social Security, this is one we are taking very, very seriously as a potential area of work. A more general point, I mean, I think we've set out a number of pilot exercises in the back of the report. We've touched on a couple of them today. I think we're very keen to make sure that we keep the committee abreast of what decisions are made vis-à-vis any extension of the NFI in future, because it feels like an important conversation for us to have with you as a committee.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for that undertaking too. I'm now going to bring in, for a final series of questions, Willie Coffey, who has got a number of areas about future developments that he's keen to probe. Willie.
Yeah, thanks, convener. Anthony, before I ask those questions on future developments, I wonder, can you clarify something about the actual figure that you reported, the 14.9 million? It's described as an outcome. Does that mean that that money is recovered or in the process of being recovered? And has it ever recovered in full?
The definition of an outcome isn't just about money that's recovered. It's also about errors that are being prevented, I think. And It's made up of a number of different components, and I'll be corrected here if I get this wrong. So sometimes it's the amount that is being sought to be recovered from an individual if there's been an overpayment or if there's been fraud. In other cases, for example, I think the rental issues, it's a figure based on were this error or fraud to have continued, this is how much it would have cost the public purse. So it's made up of a combination of different figures, Mr. Coffey.
So it's quite hard if the public were listening to this, watching this, they would want to know how much money have we lost and how much money do we ever get back. It's never clear to me in the report which it is what we're talking about, whether we ever get that money back.
I'm sorry it's not clear to you and you feel it might not be clear to the public. That's something we can go away and reflect on. I think we have to operate within the framework of the NFI, which isn't something that we entirely control ourselves, but there may be ways in which we can present that the outcomes more clearly in future. So we'll go away and reflect on that, Mr.
There's an element of it that is preventative fraud amounts that hasn't been defrauded but might have been prevented from doing so in that figure as well. And does that figure, does it go back the 2 years to the last point of the NFI, or is it in the current year? So a 2 year span.
So it's obviously based on the matches that are done as part of that exercise. It's a moment in time. But then it depends. It would be the frauds that were identified through that specific exercise and the amounts that are sought to be recovered from the individuals that have defrauded a public body at that moment in time, alongside the projections forward for those ones that rely upon an algorithm, if you like, to work out what the figures
are. But does the data that it uses go back 2 years to the commencement of the...
I'm obviously not making my point very clear. It's based on a specific date, if you like. It's a census date, if you like. So it's not going back 2 years. It's based on a date at a moment in time. But maybe you could explain it a bit more clearly. I'm trying my best, but I'm not.
Yeah. So for this report, it was all outcomes reported by councils, health boards, etc., between the 1st of April, 2020, and the 31st of March, 2022. So that would have been. The majority of that would have been related to the data that was submitted within that time. Okay. But there might also be some outcomes reported in that time that hadn't been reported in the last report because, as you appreciate, when they get a match and it takes a bit of time to undertake all the reviews, especially if they have to contact other bodies to get confirmation, if it's like, a house in one and they have to get in touch with a council down south because it appears that they've got a house down south or they're working down south and they're working in Glasgow Health Board or something like that. So there will be, it's basically everything that the bodies have reported as an outcome between those two dates, but there will be some from relating to the data from the previous exercise that hadn't previously been reported.
That's a lot clearer. Thanks very much for that. But now, turning just to the future developments that you mentioned in the report, Anthony, could you just say a wee bit more about that? There's some commentary about new types of data matching that may or may not be available to us, and that Audit Scotland has access to HMRC data that we didn't have before. We know that the Cabinet Office is consulting on potential new powers and expanding the powers in relation to all of this. So could you tell us a wee bit more about that and whether you've been part of that consultative process with the UK Government to improve this whole process?
Yeah, thank you very much. Now, we're very actively involved in those discussions, and when we're involved in those discussions, we bring to bear the views of the Public Audit Committee and your predecessor committee, and the views of the Auditor General and other interested parties as well. So Anne's very actively involved in those discussions. On the specifics, I think, of the future developments to do with whether or not the legal powers might be expanded to cover the four bullets on that page. My understanding is that the Cabinet Office has determined that, based on the consultation feedback, they aren't minded to change the legislation to expand the powers to cover those four bullets, because the general consensus from the consultees was there were risks and concerns around protecting people's identity and other kind of issues to do with data. Having said that, the Cabinet Office has recognised that there's merit in these objectives being achieved, and they're looking to other ways of delivering those improved outcomes through strengthening the role of, there's a specific team I think set up within the Cabinet Office that's working on this, and we'll be able to give you the name of the team. So that's where they're at on that, Mr. Coffey. Does that answer your question, or was there more that you wanted to know?
Well, it does partially, but have you got access to HMRC data that you didn't before, or have they ruled that out? What did you say?
No, I thought you were talking specifically about the considerations the Cabinet Office were the considerations were given by the Cabinet Office to expand the powers so that the data that's made available can be used for different purposes. So there's no change made in our access to the data. The question that was arising here was whether or not the data could be used for purposes beyond that set out in the current legislation. And as I've said, the Cabinet Office, based on the consultation, is not minded to seek changes to the legislation to allow the data that's available through the NFI process to be used for the wider purposes set out on in the bullets there. They are keen, though, to think about ways that the NFI exercise can be used in a more preventative way to help people identify positives as well as negatives. And they're also keen to think about ways in which we can use the NFI exercise to better promote anti-fraud and anti-corruption. But Anne, is there any, I'm sure I may have missed something, so I'll just hand over to Anne if that's okay.
Thanks, Anthony. Yeah, with regards to the Cabinet Office consultation on expanding their powers, they've decided not to do those at this point in time. They have said that's not to say they wouldn't do it in the future. Instead, they've decided to allocate the resource to the Counter Fraud Authority, which you might have picked up in the media around. But they were meant to launch it at the beginning of July, but that was obviously down in Westminster. There was a lot of political unrest and changes in government at that time. So they have launched a Counter Fraud Authority, and that's what they're concentrating on just now, which is sort of wider than NFI. With regards to the HMRC data, we are very, very keen to use the powers that we now have in Scotland as of, I think it was March, like, earlier this year. We have been in discussion with the Cabinet Office and HMRC to try and get access to that data. We put in a data sharing request in June to HMRC. When you put it in, you get an automatic response saying they'll reply in 21 days. They didn't reply, but we have been chasing that up. And actually this morning, there's another meeting going on just now to try and get that data sharing with HMRC progressed. Ideally, I want to use the HMRC data on payroll, pensions, and there also will be data around about, obviously it's more England, but it can relate to some of our housing sort of data sets around about, you know, who's paid stamp duty, etc. I know that's in England, but it can still help some of ours. So I'm quite positive. I don't have a timescale because, as I say, the meeting's going on just now, which we're, you know, hopefully going to try and tie the HMRC down to a timescale when we can actually share that data with ours.
OK, thanks very much for that. I completely forgot a question I was going to ask earlier. Convener, if I may ask
it. Of course you may.
It was listening to colleagues and looking at the various themes and the amounts of potential fraudulent cases and amounts. What are the preventive measures that go in to try to prevent it? I'll pick out the blue badge example particularly. It's almost £2 million every time we look at it, potentially defrauded, let's say. What are the preventative measures that go in to try and stop that, so that the next time you sit in front of us with another one of these reports, it's another £2 million?
Yeah, I mean, I think there are a number of different dimensions to this, Mr. Coffey. I mean, I guess part of the preventative measure is making sure that only the right people get the blue badge in the first place. So there's a control there about making sure that people have the right characteristics that justify them receiving a blue badge. And that happens within local authorities. I think what we identify through the NFI is more what happens when people's characteristics change or they fall out or they die while still in possession of a blue badge. I think this is an area where more real-time matching of data might help, to be honest. I also think that it's one where we would be looking for appointed auditors, both internal, well, appointed auditors, to be following up on the findings of the NFI with public bodies as well. In my response to Sharon Dowie's question, we said that this may be a blip as a consequence of COVID-19. I think we'll be wanting auditors to follow up on this in terms of, are people learning the lessons of what we found in this NFI report? And obviously, when we do the NFI in 2 years' time, we'll be able to see whether or not there have been improvements in that area.
It just seems to me, Convener, that year on year, or 2 years year on year, it's the same amount that's potentially defrauded through some of the blue badge scheme, and surely the public would expect that to go down with countermeasures and these NFI initiatives that go on. Why doesn't it go down, the public might ask?
I think Anne may want to add something to my response, Mr. Coffey, that might illuminate a bit more on this, if that's okay.
With regards to the preventative measures, obviously it's councils that are impacted by the blue badge, and the councils obviously they do report to their audit committee, and then they tend to put stuff on the website, you know, about we've identified this, blah, 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 we're catching, we're clamping down on that. So they do sort of do promotion type thing. They also use the sort of tell us ones, they promote the tell us ones to try and prevent, you know, so that as soon as someone dies, they're getting informed. And as Anthony said, ideally real-time information would be the ideal.
Okay.
So it's more sort of promotion.
Okay, well, look forward to the next report.
Yeah.
Thank you. And I think, without putting the words in the witness's mouth, I mean, I think earlier on you'd said in answer to the initial question that was put to you that obviously the incidence of mortality amongst people with disabilities was higher than the general population, and that might explain why there is a rise during this period of time. And it, I think it's worth waiting to see what the next round of NFI results tells us about that before we jump to any conclusions, I think.
Yeah.
We've got a very last question from the Deputy Convener, Sharon.
In a letter of 3rd of May, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Economy confirmed that she was keen to support Audit Scotland with any legislative changes that were required beyond any changes resulting from the Cabinet Office's consultation. She confirmed that officials would continue to work with Audit Scotland to further improve engagement with the NFI in Scotland. Can you tell us how this has been taken forward?
Anne has the operational engagement with both the NFI team, Cabinet Office and Scottish Government officials, so you may want to say a little bit more about that, if that's OK.
Yeah, thanks, Anthony. Yeah, we have obviously speak to the Cabinet Office on several times every week, and we also meet regularly with the Scottish Government. Both, they've now got a head of counter fraud, I think that's his title, in Scottish Government as of last year. So we engage regularly with him, and we also engage with the wider Scottish Government risk team, who actually pulled together the response from the CAPSEC and the action plan that's attached. So we regularly engage. The engagement wasn't so frequent during the pandemic, just due to, you know, everything was really difficult to try and get audited bodies to do more in relation to the basic on NFI, but we have opened up those discussions again over the last few months.
So there's not a lot of progress been made on it?
You know, I think I'm specifically asking, are there any plans to make changes to the primary legislation? There are no plans at the moment that we're aware of to make changes to legislation. We are still in ongoing discussions with Scottish Government officials and the Cabinet Office about whether or not they may be needed. And I think that's something we want to continue to discuss with you as a committee as well, given your strong interest in this area and given the discussion we've had today, where you've highlighted areas where you think there may be scope to further improve the NFI. We'll obviously take the feedback from today's discussion through to our discussions with both Scottish Government officials and the Cabinet Office. That's one of the purposes of coming to you today.
Thanks.
OK, well, thank you very much indeed. And can I thank both Anthony and Anne for your time and for the level of information that you've given us this morning. I think that's been really helpful, giving us some direct answers to some quite important direct questions that we've been keen to put to you. So can I thank you very much once again, and we shall no doubt see you in the future on this subject. But for the time being, can I suspend the meeting in order to allow a changeover of witnesses? Thank you. I'd like to resume this morning's consideration of evidence by the Public Audit Committee with agenda item 3, which is our continuing consideration of the Auditor General for Scotland's Section 22 report on the 2020-21 audit of the Commissioner for Ethical Standards in Public Life in Scotland. Can I welcome our witnesses this morning? We are joined by Maggie Chapman, MSP, who's a member of the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body. Alongside her is David McGill, who's the Clerk, Chief Executive of the Scottish Parliament, and Hugh Williams, who is the Private Secretary, Head of Office to the Scottish Parliament. We've received your written submissions in response to a letter that was sent in my name as the convener of the Public Audit Committee and Martin Whitfield's name as the convener of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. So we shall no doubt turn to some of the issues arising from that in the questions that we've got. We have set aside, obviously, some time for questions from members of the committee, but we'd like to offer you the opportunity to make a short opening statement, Maggie.
Good morning. Thank you very much for that, and thank the committee for giving us the opportunity to discuss the governance of office holders with you all this morning. I'm very pleased to be here on behalf of the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body, and I would like to begin by saying that the Corporate Body takes the governance of our office holders and the work that they do very, very seriously. As members of the committee will be aware, we have submitted a paper outlining the role of the SPCB and setting out the current governance arrangements. You will see from that paper that we detail further enhancements that can be made in the light of the Section 22 report on the Office of the Ethical Standards Commissioner. And I would be happy to provide the committee with information on the progress we have made. What we do not cover in that letter are the enhancements to the governance since 2002, made as a result of a number of reviews. These included a report on shared services by Audit Scotland in 2006, a comprehensive review undertaken by the then Finance Committee in 2006 into accountability and governance of office holders, the CRERA report into complaints handling, and in 2009, an ad hoc committee of the Parliament was established to examine the office holders' landscape. There were common themes coming out of these reviews, some of which are pertinent to today's meeting. These are the need to define and standardise the governance structures subsequently delivered by the Scottish Parliamentary Commissions and Commissioners, etc. Act 2010, the role of the Parliament and the need for proper scrutiny and accountability of organisations funded by the public purse. As a consequence, standing orders were changed to enable this to happen. To be clear, the position of the SPCB has the position is that the SPCB has responsibility for governance, and it is committees, parliamentary committees, that have the scrutiny role for functions undertaken by each office holder. And finally, the need for shared services. This is happening, and the co-location of several office holders offers more opportunities for future efficiencies. Thank you, Convener, for allowing me to place this on the record, and we are happy to take any questions you might have.
Thank you very much indeed. And before I turn to Sharon Dow, my observation would be that this committee is in particular interested in the history of reviews, but then in the history of the outcomes that those reviews produce. So, Sharon Dow, I'm going to ask you to open the questioning for us. Sharon.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Your submission refers to existing governance arrangements the SPCB has in place for office holders. This includes the requirement to adhere to a memorandum as well as a suite of strategic engagement documents. Is compliance with the memorandum and these documents monitored as part of the annual evaluation process undertaken by an independent assessor?
So thank you for that question. As you say, yes, as part of the governance structures we have, on appointment, the office holder receives an appointment letter which outlines the functions and the duties that they are expected to carry out. And then if they are also the accountable officer, they get this memorandum that sets out all the documents, the strategic documents, as you say. The reviews and how these are evaluated and assessed are part of the annual process that is done by the independent assessor, but it will also be something that the internal and external audit functions that are in place or should be in place, that they will take those into account as well.
Right, so did this pick up any non-compliance by the Commissioner's Office during the 2020-21 reporting period?
So one of the issues we had with the 2020 and 2021 year was that the former Ethical Standards Commissioner did not make use of either the advisory audit board that we would normally expect to be in place, and instead had another audit function that there was very, very strong advice given by the Scottish Parliament corporate body to not engage the audit process that she did do so. But the corporate body couldn't direct that. So the corporate body was limited by statute in the powers of direction that we could have. As part of the wider scope audit that was undertaken, that was when concerns began to be to be discovered. And I don't know, David, if you wanted to say a little bit more about that.
Yeah, in relation to the independent assessor, that process finally ran into the sand, unfortunately, because the former commissioner disengaged from it. That flagged up to us a bit of a weakness in the process. The process allowed for an agreed report to be submitted to the corporate body, but in the absence of agreement on the report, there was no facility for that then to be submitted to the corporate body, and that's one of the changes that we're seeking to make to the process, to make sure that if in future any office holder disengages from the process, that there is still a mechanism for that unagreed report to be submitted to the corporate body.
So a full review has been done and action has been taken on that then, on the issues that were found?
So the actions are ongoing. There have been some changes made, but part of the process, we don't just want this to affect the Ethical Standards Commissioner. We want to look across all office holders that corporate body has responsibility for. And part of that will involve negotiations and discussions about exactly what those processes are. And that is underway as part of the appointment letter and as part of the memorandum that we are going. And I don't know, Hugh, if you wanted to say a little bit more about
just that. In terms of the Ethical Standards Office, there is now an internal audit function. There is a functioning AAB that is providing valuable advice to the Acting Commissioner. We are looking again at the independent assessments process, and I think the point you make about ensuring that the governance arrangements are there is something that we can take forward as part of that review.
And you kind of mentioned it was an annual process. Is there something in place so that if issues are highlighted before the annual review takes place, that action will actually be taken then, so that it's timely rather than waiting to an annual review?
It's I think we look more towards the AAB, the Advisory Audit Board, really, for engagement with the Commissioner on a more rolling programme on that, but it's something again we can look at.
I suppose the other thing to say with that is, following discussions with office holders, what corporate body officers have instigated is a regular conversation with all office holders, usually about quarterly, and hopefully that will also act as an informal mechanism of identifying issues. It's not part of the audit process, but it's part of that wider communication and broader engagement that we know is necessary.
Thanks. Your correspondence outlines that in previous parliamentary sessions it has shared a paper with the relevant clerks on what areas the SPCB considers that committees should be scrutinising office holders on. Can you confirm whether this took place during session 5? And if not, whether the SPCB intends to resume this practice during session 6?
So, Hugh, if you want to take that, thank you.
I think on that point, what the corporate body has done now as part of its review is that it has written recently to the committee conveners group, looking to see some of the points highlighted in the section 22 report was about the scrutiny function. So we're looking at seeking agreement in principle from committee conveners to a written agreement whereby this could set out the role of the corporate body, the role of committees, and what functions they could undertake. I think once committee conveners have agreed in principle, if they do so, we can then look at the detail of the written agreements and bring in the points that you raise about looking at more committee engagement and what sort of engagement that should be.
So this is work in progress at the moment then?
Yes.
And is there a timeline on it?
We only wrote, the presiding officer only wrote to the committee conveners last week, so I think it's subject to obtaining an agreement from committee conveners.
And is that something that this committee could be updated on?
Of course.
Thanks. Okay. Can I take you back to Sharon Dower's initial question there, which was that in session five, did the practice of conferring with the clerks about areas the corporate body considers that committee should scrutinise office holders on, did that take place in session five? Yes or no?
I think the answer to that is it was sporadic, yes. And I think the corporate body's proactive approach to instigating that was probably lax in session five. I think there was a reliance on the fact that historically standing orders had been changed to oblige the clerk of the parliament to submit annual reports to committees, and that would trigger the committee's scrutiny of it. So the corporate body did not follow up on that to see that committee scrutiny was taking place. So I think in some instances there was good engagement between parliamentary committees and office holders, and in other cases there weren't. And I think also it's worth saying that for at least one of the office holders, the Information Commissioner, for example, it doesn't fit neatly within the remit of any parliamentary committee. So there's a challenge there to make sure that that body and that office holder is properly scrutinised by parliamentary committees.
Thank you. I mean, in a sense, one of the things that we are interested in is the gap that may exist between the theory and the practice.
Yeah.
And whether what you've outlined is good practice is actually being followed through, and was it followed through in session five, and how did we come to this? And I guess one of the underlying issues here, which I think was outlined in the letter that Martin Whitfield and myself wrote to you initially around our concerns that came out of the Section 22 report by Audit Scotland, was that how could things have got to this stage without there being a much earlier intervention? Can I turn to, again, something else that's referred to in the correspondence, which is about enhanced government enhanced governance arrangements, which, again, in the report, the expression uses that they had deteriorated to a significant degree. So, you know, it is a record of there being, you know, quite deep-seated problems that exist inter-institution almost. And could you perhaps outline to us what progress you've made in that area of enhancing the government arrangements and seeking to address what clearly have been deficiencies that have led us to the situation that gave rise to the Section 22 report into the Ethical Standards Commission?
OK, so I'll start and then ask David and Hugh to pick up anything that I miss out. I think it's fair to say we are in process of the enhancement of governance structures and arrangements that we want to see. We are reviewing material provided to new office holders by their office to satisfy ourselves that all governance relationships with the corporate body and Parliament more generally is accurate and is accurately stated. And that will be part of the appointment letter and the terms of engagement that office holders have. We are looking to introduce a code of conduct, and that will be done in negotiation with with existing office holders as well, to make sure that there aren't any changes or unexpected new things that they have to do without their engagement in that discussion as part of the process. We want to make sure that arrangements are made by office holders to have access to an internal audit function. And we know that for all commissioners, that is the case, with the exception of the biometrics commissioner, who's the newest commissioner. But that process is in place. It's to get that internal audit process is underway. We're also seeking copies of all external reports, and that will be part of the regular procedures that corporate body undertakes on a regular basis. And as I say, at an official level, meeting formally with office holders on an individual basis, quarterly, arranging for the SPCB portfolio member who holds responsibility for office holders to be in some of those conversations when appropriate. And I suppose just on that, those regular quarterly meetings, I suppose it's important to state that they aren't only corporate body business agenda items that will be discussed. Office holders will be encouraged to engage with setting the agenda for those conversations, to be able to raise issues. We want to very much make this a conversation, a two-way communication process, rather than it being a we need you to do this or we need you to give us this. So there has to be that dialogue. And I think it's fair to say that corporate bodies of the view that we need to improve communications across the board. It's not just between corporate body and office holders. As people have already indicated, we need committees to be involved in that process as their responsibility for scrutiny and operational functions. But there are also others, the Standards Commissioner, for instance, you know, being part of more broad conversation and communication to try and ensure that this kind of thing doesn't happen again.
Okay.
If Hugh or David want to say anything else about that.
Yeah, I mean, I think Maggie Chapman's given some of the details of the changes that we're seeking to implement here. But taking a step back, these have come out of a thoroughgoing review that we've instigated of all of the ways in which the corporate body gets assurance on the governance framework around office holders. And there are five ways in which the corporate body does that. Firstly, external audit overseen by Audit Scotland. And in the discussions we've had with office holders, they've reported to us that that process works very well. However, it may be focused very heavily on the financial aspects of it. And I've spoken informally to the Auditor General about the possibility of the scope of that being extended more into to governance areas. That's obviously a matter for the Auditor General. Second area is the independent assessor. We've spoken about the weaknesses in that, the changes that we're going to make there. Third area is the advisory audit board function, and there were particular reasons in these circumstances why that broke down that we're addressing. Fourth area is the annual certificate of insurance that office holders are obliged to submit to me as the principal accountable officer. And finally, the area of committee scrutiny that we've touched on again. I mean, the review flushed out that there are weaknesses in all of that, but this was on the basis of 20 years of this working well, and what we hadn't anticipated and what we hadn't designed into the features of all of this was for the possibility of an office holder disengaging from the process. And that's the perspective we've taken as part of this review, and it's led to some of the improvements that Maggie's set out.
Okay, thank you for that. I'm anxious to move us on. I've just got one almost factual question to put to you, which is that I think since April 2021, the head of corporate services has been the accountable officer for the Ethical Standards in Public Life Scotland Commission. We understand that you are in the process of recruiting a new commissioner for ethical standards in public life. Will that new post holder also be the accountable officer?
I think that's a good question, and I'm not sure we have a definitive answer on that yet. I think at the time when the acting commissioner was appointed, it was appropriate to split the role, and as you've seen in comments from the auditors, that's not an unusual situation. At the time, that decision was taken so the acting commissioner could focus on remedying the issues that had arisen in the office: breakdown of relationships, backlog of workload, all of those kinds of things. I think that there's something to consider further with the new commissioner when they are appointed, how that has been going, and whether it would be appropriate to retain that split for a limited period of time or to revert back to the expected combined roles. I think that is a conversation that we would have with the new appointee.
Okay, but that wouldn't be something then that you would prescribe. It wouldn't be part of the job advert and the job description for people applying for that post. I haven't looked at what the job advert says. Does it say you will be, or you may be, or you might not be the accountable officer?
So the expectation is that the job does have those two roles combined. But given this, the situation that we're in with this specific role, I think it's would only be fair to the incoming commissioner to be fully open about why it's not been combined for the last 18 months and what the process for the future looks like.
Sorry, but do I infer from that, Maggie, that you're saying that your expectation is that that new postholder will be the accountable officer?
Yes.
OK, thank you. Willie Coffey has got some questions. Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener. I just wanted to turn to the auditor's report and recommendations. We're an audit committee and we're always keen to follow up on whether recommendations are accepted and in process. I understand there were 22 recommendations made, some of which apply directly to the SPCB. For example, one of them was about reporting routes for various concerns. We clarified what we're doing in relation to that. Another one was reviews of the overall governance structures and also a point about continually assessing whether these things remain adequate. There's an interesting quote from the presiding officer in paragraph 6 that says there was no follow-up from the auditor prior to or following these recommendations. So the question for me is, have we embraced these recommendations in any case, and are we carrying them through?
So, corporate body does recognise and take on board all of the recommendations, particularly the ones, there are three that refer directly to corporate body functions. I think it's fair to say that there hasn't been, the auditors didn't engage with corporate body formally as part of this process. And I think as I said earlier, I think one of the things we want to do is make sure that we do have the genuine engagement across all of the interested stakeholders and interested parties, whilst ensuring that we aren't seen to be interfering, because obviously the work of the Commission has to be independent of corporate body and of MSPs, members and Parliament. So in terms of do we accept the recommendations, I think there are the recommendations that apply directly to the functions and powers of corporate body, yes, and we are working to ensure that we implement the changes that are needed, including around governance. There are some connections with those two operations and the functions of the Commissioner's office, and it would be inappropriate for us to direct in that view. But I don't know, David, if you wanted to say or Hugh a little bit more about that.
I think one thing I would add is that we do take the report very, very seriously, and we are looking at governance, particularly so that we know that there's more commissioners coming in the pipeline. Yeah. You know, the corporate body is likely to be invited to take on more commissioners, so we really do need to have the governance framework working as it should be.
Mm-hmm. It's just to get that assurance from you, Maggie, that the recommendations that are aimed at yourselves are in train,
yes,
and being worked on.
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
Thanks. I'm going to bring Willie back in later on, but I'm going to now switch to Craig Hoy, who's got a couple of questions to put. Craig.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Ms. Chapman and other witnesses. I just want to focus in just a little bit on the progress that's been made since, obviously, this situation emerged. It's quite clear that the Auditor General's report identifies that relationships had deteriorated to a pretty poor standard. So how have those working relationships between the Commissioner's Office, the Standards Commission and the corporate body and the committees of the Scottish Parliament improved since, let's say, the nadir?
So thank you for that question. I think the work of the Commissioner would be impossible, and I think maybe not impossible, but nigh on impossible, without good relationships across the board. And I think that's what we saw break down with the former commissioner. The acting commissioner has worked very hard to re-engage with stakeholders, including corporate body, but external stakeholders as well, to rebuild trust and to rebuild just that communication process, which had become non-existent. And I think when the acting commissioner gave evidence to another parliamentary committee earlier this year, outlined exactly what he had done in that. So he'd engaged with COSLA, he'd engaged with local authorities, he'd engaged with the chief executives and senior managers of local authorities through Solace, and he had engaged with other public bodies that would ordinarily we would expect to have a relationship with the Commission. So the acting commissioner has done a lot of work over the last 18 months to rebuild trust, to rebuild that engagement. And I think it's important to say that part of that has also been the work that he has done to support the staff in the Commissioner's office to make sure that they are able to reach out to people they need to speak to and that they will get the kinds of information that those relationships can be rebuilt to ensure effective working across different public bodies.
Okay, just in relation to something you said earlier, Ms. Chapman, in relation to improving communications between all the relevant stakeholders. Obviously, the public trust is important in this as well.
Yeah.
You know there's been quite considerable media interest in the weaknesses in governance at the Ethical Standards Commissioner. From a corporate body point of view, do you think that you have effectively communicated and do you think you've had sufficient levels of transparency, both in relation to parliamentary inquiries and also media inquiries that have come in relation to the activities within the office and the corporate body's role within that?
Can I just be clear that you're asking about how we've communicated to the public or to commissioners?
As the corporate body, both within Parliament and, for example, in relation to media inquiries that have come to the corporate body. Do you think that you've had sufficient levels of communications and transparency in relation to your dealings with external agencies principally?
Okay, so some of the media inquiries that we've had refer directly to the former commissioner, and it would be inappropriate for us to comment publicly anyway, at any point in this process about that. And I think our communications were clear on that. In terms of the actions that have been taken and that have been put in place, I hope that we have been clear and transparent in what corporate body has done, what the acting commissioner has been seeking to do over the last 18 months. In terms of answering challenging questions, I think that there are, I suppose, boundaries of responsibility to be aware of here as well. So as we've already indicated, there's a role for corporate body in ensuring governance processes are in place. The commissioners' offices, the office holders themselves, have a very, very clear responsibility in making sure that happens. And there are limits to the extent to which we can then direct if commissioners and office holders disengage. I think there's also a clear opportunity for us, as David and Hugh have indicated, to improve discussion between corporate body and committees. And I think we've been open about that, to say we want a stronger relationship between the corporate body and the committees that scrutinise the functions of the office holders. And I would welcome that ongoing process to continue.
OK, just in relation to compliance with Standards Commission statute directions, the statute directions were issued by the Standards Commission at the Commissioner's Office in 2021 for the first time. And in April 2021, the Standards Commission concluded there had been a contravention of the direction, and that the convener of the Standards Commission should send the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body a formal complaint. Just looking at the position today regarding compliance with the Standards Commission's statutory directions, are you confident that they are being upheld?
Yes.
OK, fine. And just wondering if you'd perhaps give the committee an update in relation to agreeing and implementing a full investigations manual that could be used moving forward. Is there an update you can provide in relation to that?
So I can probably say that the manual is in process. Hugh will be able to give a little bit more detail on the specifics.
There is a manual in place. Coincidentally, just yesterday, the Commissioner has consulted stakeholders on an update to the manual. For openness and transparency, he is this time looking for views from the likes of the corporate body, committees, other external stakeholders about the manual.
And you're confident that it would be sufficiently robust?
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
Yes. I'm not sure, Mr. Williams, this committee believes in coincidence, but anyway. but we would be keen to be kept abreast of the progress that you are making, because that was an important recommendation in the Auditor-General's report. I'm going to bring back in Willie Coffey, who's got another couple of questions he wants to put before I turn to least but not last, or last but not least, Colin Beattie. Willie.
Thanks, Convener. It's just really a follow-on from the question asked by Craig Hoy. The Auditor also said that all the eligibility decisions about assessment criteria should be reviewed externally by an external investigator. I think it was in the auditor's report. Could you clarify if that's been done?
So, David, are you going to take this?
Well, yeah. I mean,
First of all, I mean, that's obviously a matter for the Acting Commissioner, but my understanding is that the Acting Commissioner has taken legal advice and there are legal barriers to the reinvestigation of historic complaints.
How could you advise this committee about the outcome to that? Because we're clearly interested in following through the recommendations to make sure that they're actioned.
Yeah, he's taken advice on that, and decisions, once they are taken, cannot be reopened. They could be used as a learning exercise for staff. The Acting Commissioner, we understand, has discussed this position with the Standards Commission, and he has also advised the external auditors of the position. He has to act within the statutory legislation that is in place for him.
Okay, is that something you could update us on at an appropriate time, Maggie, David?
I mean, I suppose given the decision that the legal advice not to, or the inability to reopen those decisions, the Standards Commissioner has been advised of that and is content with that process. I suppose if anything comes back from the audit, from the auditors, that is something that we can certainly update committee about.
Okay, thank you for that. And the other question was, I think you made mention of yourself, Maggie, about funding implications of all these reviews and processes and the impact on workforce planning and so on. Could you just say a little more about that, please?
Yeah, I think one of the challenges that the Acting Commissioner has been dealing with over the last year is putting into place some of the HR processes that we would expect to be in place that had fallen away. So things like performance management processes. Every staff member within the Commission now has an action plan, an individual action plan around their own performance, what's expected of them. There's been training and guidance issued on a whole suite of activities, including, I suppose, how to deal with some of the increasing complexities of cases that the Commission officials have to deal with. I think it's also worth noting that the corporate body will be discussing next week the business case, which includes workforce planning as part of that, a detailed workforce plan. We had hoped to discuss that a couple of weeks ago, but that meeting was postponed because of the mourning period. So that meeting is taking place next Thursday.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for that.
Okay, can I just pick up again that point that Willie Coffey alluded to? I mean, the paragraph 18 of the Auditor General's Section 22 report points out that in 2016-17, 43% of complaints against councils and board members were not pursued further. But by the time we get to 2020-21, 84% of cases lodged were not pursued. Now, there might have been an increase in vexatious cases, possibly inflating that number. But the Auditor General's conclusion talks about a loss of corporate memory, significant staff turnover. It is likely attributable to a change to the way in which incoming complaints were initially assessed. So I hear what's been said about we've taken legal advice and you can't reopen cases and so on. But if I'm one of those people who's lodged a complaint about the misconduct of a councillor, an MSP, a board member from an NHS board or whatever, and lodged with an organisation which clearly was malfunctioning, do I not? Why is it so categorical that the door is closed to me to raise that, with an organisation which has now been made fit for purpose, which, according to the Section 22 report, wasn't at that time?
No, I can understand where that question comes from and the frustration that some people may well feel. Corporate body doesn't have the power to direct the Commissioner to reopen and reinvestigate that. That is up to the Commissioner to take that decision. And having sought legal advice, the Acting Commissioner has been very clear that he cannot do that. What they are what the Acting Commissioner has done, as indicated in an earlier response, is advise the Standards Commission of this, and the Standards Commissioner is content with the rationale for that. I think that the broader point around making sure that cases that are still not dealt with are dealt with effectively, and that is why a corporate body will be discussing the workforce plan, which includes additional resources to deal with this, with open complaints next week.
But that sounds a bit like the institutions are happy, but what about the complainants? You don't need to answer that question.
Thanks.
Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. Morning. Over a period of many years now, this committee has sat and looked at report after report from the Auditor General, which highlighted failures in governance. And it seems at times that it's almost endemic, and it's really disappointing that the SPCB falls into the same category. It seems like an extraordinary failure in governance, and I would ask you quite simply, I mean, was your governance fit for purpose during this period?
I think, as we have attempted to outline already, that there were things that we are in the process of strengthening, which implies, I suppose, that they could have been stronger previously. I think one of the things to be clear about is, again, the boundaries of responsibility. Corporate body has powers to act in certain instances, but not all instances. One of the really important elements of office holders' work is that they are independent. They are independent of direction from corporate body. So whilst corporate body can provide funding, can provide the approval or otherwise of annual budgets, approving staff numbers, staff structures, the corporate body has a role in overseeing the governance structures, and we can contribute to and comment on strategic plans and the like. The governance functions of the external auditors and the internal auditors really are what bolsters that. And as we saw with the Ethical Standards Commission, that the former commissioner disengaged from us, disengaged from the external auditors, imposed external auditors that corporate body advised her not to do. And I suppose the way that we have closed that gap, if you like, what we are seeking to do is in appointment letters and in the code of conduct that Hugh referred to earlier, failure to engage will become a breach of the relationship, a breach of appointment, terms of appointment. That wasn't the case previously. We hope that in the future that will be the case.
An awful lot of what you're saying is very similar to what we've heard in other instances of governance failures, where there's a lot to be done afterwards, but during the time the governance was weak. Now, at what point did you actually realise that the governance structure was failing?
David, do you want to?
On your initial point, I entirely understand the question, but I'm not sure that I would characterise the governance framework as failing in this instance. I think what we're seeing is that aspects of it were not strong enough for these particular circumstances, but I would stress that this framework has been in place in pretty much the form it's in just now for the best part of 20 years, and we've never experienced a circumstance like this before. I think one of the biggest areas of weakness that we've identified is that failing between things that fall between two stools on the corporate body's responsibility for governance and on the committee's side for functions. And some of the failings that have been identified here are failings of functions, so they were not things that the corporate body would necessarily be responsible for.
That you said, would have sight of it.
Sorry?
You would have sight of it, given what Ms Chapman's already described as your oversight.
Yes, and coming to your second question, when we started to become aware of these failings, it wasn't one particular or single instance, it was a number of things that happened round about the same time. So, for example, the first thing we became aware of was the dispute between the former commissioner and the Standards Commission on the directions. Round about the same time, we were in discussions with the former commissioner about her views on an advisory audit board, which were very much at odds with our views on that. As Maggie has said, that's not something that we, the corporate body, has the ability to direct on, but we very strongly advise that she engage with external auditors on the concerns that we had. And again, we've talked earlier about the difficulties with the independent assessment, and that came around about the same time. So there were two or three different avenues of concerns that were coming to our attention round about the same time, which was summer to winter of 2020.
Were you satisfied that you had sufficient processes in place to highlight when these issues were coming up? For example, when were you cited on the fact that there were statutory directions coming from the Standards Commission, which is quite extraordinary, you know, as an event?
Yes, we were made aware of that, I think, in August of 2020. There was a dispute about the ability of the Standards Commission to issue those directions, so we took legal advice on that. Our view was very much that the Standards Commission had that statutory ability. That wasn't accepted by the other party, so we took our legal advice and then communicated that legal advice to the former commissioner, and that was the extent to which the corporate body, given the fact that we cannot direct, the Standards Commission can, but we cannot direct, that was the extent to which the corporate body had the powers to intervene in that dispute.
Were you automatically advised of these statutory directions?
No, we weren't. That's a matter entirely for the Commission. There's no provision in the statute for them to be automatically transmitted to the corporate body.
And yet it's an indication of a failure of governance, potentially, within the Commission.
Potentially, yes. I mean, the ability has always been there in the statute to make sure that the overall governance framework works smoothly. But yes, you're right, they hadn't been recourse to issuing directions before that point.
But you had substantial influence over the Commissioner, given your role, and you do have an oversight role there. How did you engage with the Commissioner? Was there regular meetings? Was there exchanges of information?
There was, yes. We do have influence to an extent, but as we've pointed out, we don't have any powers of direction, and the office holders are appointees rather than employees, so we don't have the influence that you would have over an employee. But yes, I met with the former commissioner on two occasions, and I engaged in lengthy correspondence over a period of months with her on all of the issues that we've discussed this morning.
So where would an escalation process be? The whole thing broke down, the governance broke down. Your relationship presumably became a bit strained, given the differences of opinion and so forth. Where would you normally go from there? How would the escalation process work?
The escalation process, depending on whichever issue it was that was being escalated, would be normally through parliamentary committees or straight to the Parliament if we weren't escalating it to that level. Again, we reached an impasse on various issues, and that was then compounded by the former commissioner being on extended leave for a period of time, so we did not have the ability to continue the engagement that we'd been trying to maintain with her.
Given the failure within the organisation, given the fact that the longer inaction on the part of SPCB was concerned would lead to unfortunate outcomes in terms of investigations and so on being carried out, would it not have been appropriate to bring it to Parliament, to bring the problem to Parliament?
I think because of the impasse that was reached and because of the position that we were confronted with the Commissioner being on a period of extended leave, the corporate body's focus was very much on ensuring that the governance framework was improved and was working to a satisfactory extent. And that's why the corporate body appointed an acting commissioner in the first place. It's why they separated out the roles of commissioner and accountable officer. Corporate body also moved very quickly to respond to a relatively modest request for an increase in the staffing complement to allow the acting commissioner to respond to the issues that were being addressed. So the corporate body's focus was very much on getting the office back on track and making sure that their part of the ethics framework in Scotland was working as it should be.
Given that practically everybody, staff, almost everybody you can point at in the Commission was underperforming for various reasons, would there not have been a degree of greater urgency, of necessity to act swiftly to rectify the situation, much more quickly than it appears to have happened, given the timescales?
Yeah, I mean, that's something that I'm more than happy to look at, but I don't recall a lack of urgency. I think the corporate body did move swiftly to make sure that the office was functioning the way that it required to function.
Give me a timescale.
I think in the early part of 2021, when we were reaching an impasse on various issues and the former commissioner went on extended leave, the corporate body moved immediately to appoint an acting commissioner and focused its energy on working with that acting commissioner to get the office working in the way that it should be.
And I suppose it's worth saying that prior to the former commissioner going on extended leave, there were repeated attempts by corporate body to contact her, to engage with her, and those attempts were ignored, even when deadlines were given and that and very, very clear requests for information were made. I think one of the ways in which we hope to ensure that that can't happen again is make that kind of disengagement a breach of the appointment guideline, a breach of the appointment contract. So that would be... We didn't have those powers there, and the new terms and conditions for future appointments will include that as a breach.
What would have happened if the previous commissioner hadn't gone on leave and you continue with the impasse? What would you have done?
I think it would have been at that point that we would have sought to use one of the mechanisms that corporate body has to bring the issue to Parliament. So the office an office holder could be removed from office if the corporate body is satisfied that they breached their terms and conditions. As I said, there wasn't a clear breach there because disengagement wasn't one of the terms and conditions. But I think if what we would have been able to do is have a discussion with Parliament about whether we'd lost confidence in the commissioner. That would be the only other mechanism open to us. But because the former commissioner was on extended leave, it was not we couldn't engage in that process.
I think one concern is over an extended period there was obviously a lot going on in the background. And it's a question of, you know, transparency around all this, because for many, many months complaints were coming in, being dealt with, not being dealt with, people's futures were being compromised in one way or another, potentially. And over that entire period, whatever was going on behind closed doors was not really contributing to that. Would it have been better if this had been a more open process?
Can I just understand if what had been a more open process?
If the problem and the efforts to resolve it had been more open.
I think that there were challenges around who knew what when, and one of the things that we have and are putting in place, I think they're in place across all commission, all office holders now, is a whistleblowing process for staff. There wasn't a process where staff could raise concerns with an external body. The process was an internal one through the commissioner, and obviously that in this case wasn't appropriate.
Wouldn't that have been a governance issue?
And we have now ensured that there is a process for all staff in all office holders.
It seems that you're backfilling deficiencies that were in place under the previous system, and that in fact the previous system wasn't actually fit for purpose, and you're now trying to put something in place that will be. hopefully. When will you be assessing the new governance structure that you've got? When will there be some sort of assessment available on that?
So that is an ongoing process that corporate body is undertaking, looking at the different documentation that currently exists, how we seek to amend that, the code of conduct that will be part of the appointment of office holders that Hugh mentioned earlier. I think it would be appropriate once all of those changes are agreed across all office holders, corporate body will then take a look at how things are functioning once all of that has happened. But we are still undertaking the work required to meet the recommendations of the Section 22 report.
Are you working with Audit Scotland on this at all? I'm thinking of some sort of independent review once you've put the amended processes in place, mm-hmm. to get an independent review as to the adequacy of them, given the problems in the past.
Hugh, do you want to?
We can certainly look at that.
Yeah. Yeah. Personally, I recommend it. Given the experience that Like of Audit Scotland's had elsewhere with similar governance failures.
That's a helpful suggestion. Thank you.
Thank you.
OK, thanks. Well, on that constructive suggestion by the committee to our witnesses, can I draw this morning's evidence session to a close and thank Maggie Chapman, David McGill and Hugh Williams for being prepared to come to the committee this morning and to answer the questions that we've got and to respond to what is, I think, by common consent, has been a very difficult situation and has raised some pretty fundamental questions about the governance structures and whether or not they needed to be reformed. As I said, we are a committee that is principally concerned about outcomes and not necessarily reviews, and so we will be keeping a close eye. I'm quite sure we'll discuss our next steps, but I'm sure we'll be keeping a close eye to understand how effective any changes that you've heralded are implemented. But thank you once again for your time this morning. I now close the public part of this morning's meeting to a close. Thank you.